Do you want to make a Game Boy emulator?
You should, and I can help.
Maybe you're not sure, though. Here's a few reasons why you should. For me, having a project and a concrete end goal is one of the best ways to learn. That goal helps to motivate you and keep you on track. And writing an emulator gives you lots of different opportunities and challenges to learn new things, like binary data manipulation, machine code interpretation, and graphics and audio programming. And it'll give you a deeper appreciation of computer architecture. It's also a good project if you want to learn a new language and need an excuse to help you learn. I'm not sure if it's ideal for someone who's completely new to programming, but hey, it's better than starting out making an MMO game. The nice thing about a Game Boy emulator is that it's a nice big project. It can give you practice coming up with a project plan and segmenting a large project into smaller sub-projects. Which brings me to reason two. A Game Boy emulator has all these small parts that you can break off and work on as a project in and of itself. If you're mostly interested in how Game Boy graphics work, you can just implement your own graphics system. I've been slowly building a Game Boy graphics rendering system in JavaScript for my Game Boy graphics videos. If you're interested in sound, then you can implement the Game Boy's audio processing unit, like GitHub user ShambleSides did when creating an implementation of the APU with JavaScript bindings, so that you can produce Game Boy audio from modern JavaScript in the browser. I've used it to generate some sound effects for my videos. I'll link to the GitHub in the description. A good place to start, if you do plan on building a full emulator, would be a tool to disassemble a Game Boy ROM to turn it from binary machine code back into somewhat readable assembly code. My third reason is that I think the Game Boy hits a sweet spot of complexity. It's complicated enough to be interesting, but not so complicated that you can't keep enough of the details in your head at one time. The instruction set is pretty small, so you won't get lost implementing instruction after instruction, like if you were trying to implement an x86 interpreter for some reason. The graphic system is subtle enough, with enough edge cases and little bugs, that you'll probably be banging your head on the wall just enough to feel accomplished when you finally get it working. Fourth, it's a nice, concrete, tangible project that gives you something you can show off at the end. Once you're far enough along on the emulator, you'll be able to write your own Game Boy code and see it running on the thing you built. That's awesome! Or you can try existing ROMs to see how far you've gotten with accuracy. That brings me to my final point. There are so many resources available to help you on this project. The Game Boy is extensively documented, and there are a bunch of helpful ROMs that people have built to help you test your emulator. The place to start is gbdev.io. It has a cool animation of the Game Boy on the main page, and it's really the gateway to all things Game Boy dev. They also have a Discord server with a channel dedicated to emulator development. Another invaluable resource is Pandocs. You can get to this from gbdev.io, but I want to call it out specifically. It's an extensive documentation and explanation of how the Game Boy works. I refer to it constantly while working on my other Game Boy videos. Another handy resource is gekkyo.fi. In particular, the Game Boy Complete Technical Reference. That gives detailed information about the Game Boy's architecture, instruction execution timing, and bus signaling. I refer to the bus timing diagram so much, I think I have at least two copies of it printed out, and I keep misplacing them. I especially needed them when working on my silly flashcard videos. The RGBDS opcode reference is a handy documentation of the Game Boy's assembly code instructions to know what they all do. If you want a flashier way of exploring the Game Boy's instruction set, you can check out Megan Sullivan's interactive CPU instruction page. And don't worry, I'll link to all these resources in the video description. Really, I could end the video there. There's just so much information available there. It's really everything you need. But maybe I can give you some more pointers. An important thing your emulator is going to need to do is get code to execute. On a real Game Boy, that code comes from a game cartridge. But most Game Boy cartridges aren't just a simple memory chip in a plastic shell. I mean, Tetris is, but not all of them. That's because the Game Boy was only designed to handle 32 kilobytes of ROM data from a cartridge. Most games are bigger than that. They get around that limitation by having a chip in the cartridge called a memory bank controller, or MBC. The MBC controls what chunk of the ROM is visible to the Game Boy at any given time. So if you want your emulator to support games that are bigger than 32 kilobytes, it's also going to need to emulate the MBC that would be inside the game's cartridge. There are a few different NPCs, and they're all a little different. Luckily, a game's ROM has a section that tells you what kind of NPC and what hardware features the game has. There aren't that many NPCs, and most work roughly the same, so it doesn't add that much work to support them. The Game Boy also has a few hardware bugs that you're going to have to implement if you want to have an accurate emulator. Two that come to mind are the window bug and the OAM corruption bug. The window bug causes the window layer to be drawn incorrectly when the WX value is 0 or 166. The OAM corruption bug causes corrupt data to be written to the OAM if you execute certain types of instructions during specific times while the Game Boy is rendering the screen. This affects how sprites get rendered on the Game Boy. There's also some less obvious behavior, like the window internal line counter that controls how the window layer is rendered. I only learned about it from a friend who was making his own emulator. These are just some of the exciting details you'll have to contend with when building a Game Boy emulator. And remember, if you do decide to build a Game Boy emulator, it doesn't matter if you end up making a perfect, cycle-accurate emulator of everyone's dreams, or you just learn a few cool details about how the Game Boy works. What matters is having fun and following your interests. I hope this helped you get started on your journey to create a Game Boy emulator. Bye!